My dear brothers, what is Ruhaniyat? Can the saints help us after their death? Seeing that people go there after their death for help. The word that has been used by the questioner is a bit vague. He has used the word Ruhaniyat, which when translated into English means spirituality or spiritualism. Now the concept of spirituality or spiritualism varies from people to people. The Hindu spiritualists who are called yogis, they also claim to possess Ruhaniyat. The Buddhist spiritualists or mystics, their bhikshus and their lamas and others, they also claim to possess spiritual powers and spirituality. Similarly, Christian mystics, similarly primitive mystics who play the voodoo or other things on the continent of Africa, they also claim to possess Ruhaniyat or spirituality. And the Muslim spiritual luminaries, about them also we believe that they possessed spiritual powers and they were spiritually elevated. So in this connection, first of all, this concept has got to be made clear. Now, as people generally say, that the human personality is composed of three things: body, mind and soul. Body exists in spatio-temporal dimensions. It exists in space and time. The mind exists only in temporal dimension, not in space, while the soul exists as a spaceless and timeless entity. Now, unless a person is able to understand the distinctions between the characteristics of these three components of the human personality, it is not possible to have any clear or fair idea of what Ruhaniyat means, especially for a Muslim, and of course even objectively. Now, the first thing to be understood is what is space and what is time? Because when we say that the physical bodies are spatio-temporal, we mean to say that they exist in the dimensions of space and time. Now, space has been defined by the most eminent scientific philosophers as extension, and time has been defined as duration. Then, in modern physics, which deals with space and time, numerous problems have arisen during the present century. And the modern physicists have been forced to accept the fact that the space as we know it in terms of extension is not the only form of space, and that the time as we know it in terms of duration is not the only form of time. For instance, the problem which emerges in connection with space and time in physics, when a scientist studies the behavior of the electron as it jumps from one orbit to the other and is all the time jumping, its behavior is this, that it exists on the orbit from where it takes jump. It exists on the orbit where it lands, but it ceases to exist in space or time, in between. And consequently, the scientists have been intrigued by this. Different theories came into the field, and finally, it was Whitehead, the British scientist and physicist and philosopher, who finally came to the rescue and said that the electron in the intervening space and time between one orbit and the other exists in the fifth dimension. Now here comes the question. You want to ask me about Ruhaniyat, you see, you will have to go with me through all these problems. Now, we have now come to the problem of dimensions. And we are talking only of space and time. In connection with dimensions, to be very simple, every physical thing has three physical dimensions: length, breadth, and thickness. This is according to Newtonian physics, or the physics of Muslim masters of Isaac Newton. But during the present century, Einstein came forward to challenge it, and he said that every physical body exists in four dimensions, and time is the fourth dimension. Now, the behavior of between the sun and the moon and the earth, it is not something existent by itself. It is not something tangible. It is only a relation. It is not something tangible like the microphone. It is not even something tangible like a human idea or thought in the mind. It is pure duration, and that duration comes into existence through the relationship of the sun and the earth and the moon. When they go in for anatomy of time, anatomy of serial time, the doctor has taken the chair, he is an anatomist, so I should speak about the anatomy of time. Time is composed, according to them, of individual nows. And now, N-O-W, it is composed of individual nows, as a line in geometry is conceived to be composed of points. Now, just as the points which go to constitute space, all space is made up of points. But when you ask a scientist what is a point, he says a point is that which has no length and no breadth and no thickness. Then you ask him the question, what is a line? He says that a line is an aggregate of points, but it has length, no breadth and no thickness, but it has length all the same. Then you ask him the question, if there is no length in a point, if the length in a point is zero, then zeros added ad infinitum equal to zero. 1,000,000 zeros are equal to zero. You see? Then from where does this come in? Here again comes this problem of the mystic problem. It's right there in the foundations of science. You see, a line is composed of points. And a point has zero length, but a line has got length. Then four lines make a square. A square has length and breadth. No thickness, of course. But a square is made up of lines. The lines are made up of points. Point has no length and no breadth. From where has this length and breadth come into the square? Then six squares go to make a cube. A cube is a solid body. A cube is a solid body. The cube has length, breadth, and thickness. The cube is made up of squares. The squares are made up of lines. The lines are made up of points. And a point has no length and no breadth and no thickness. Which in the final analysis, every cube is made up of points. Here we are talking of space. So the foundations of space is zero entity. Then from where this tangibility in space or in physical bodies? This much about space. Now about time. When you analyze serial time, it is an aggregate of individual time instants, to use the term of science. Time instants. And every time instant is an individual now. But the nature of this individual now is that as soon as it comes into being, it vanishes. If you look at the clock or at your watch, wristwatch, and you say that the time is 9 hours, 25 minutes, 1 second. Now the moment you say this, you perceive this 1 second, it is not there and it will never come back. This instant of time will never return. It has passed into oblivion and it has passed into death. So the moment time comes into existence, it dies. This is serial time. Here again the mystic element comes in. If time is constituted of time instants which are of zero value as regards duration, then from where does come the permanence in the existence of those things which are spatio-temporal? Where from does come the permanence in history, that there is a past and there is a present, and of course man has always got in his mind the idea of the future. What is it that contains this past, present and future? So the philosophers try to go beyond serial time. They say that serial time is not the only form of time. There is another form of time also, and that is universal time. Universal time is the vehicle which holds serial time, which holds the past and the present and the future as a unity, as an organic unity. And unless past, present and future are viewed as an organic unity, it will be impossible for human beings to understand life. It will all be a state of confusion. Now, physical science is possible for human beings. Physical science would not be possible until and unless there is an element of permanence in time and in space. What is that element of permanence? Science cannot give an answer. And so the mystic comes in. And he takes up that thread from where the physical scientist leaves it. I'll stop this talk right here on this point, then go to another point in this connection. It is said that man is composed of the body and the mind and the soul. It has been believed in by all the human communities of the world, except the modern materialists, the modern behavioristic psychologists, the exponents of the school of psychology, which is called behaviorism or mechanistic psychology. They say that even mind does not exist. It is only the brain which exists, and the brain works as a computer system. Somehow, if you ask them how, they say somehow. And what you call the mind is only a fantasy. Then if you ask them, what about the ideas and what about memory? They say that the brain secretes thoughts as the liver secretes the bile. And this secretion takes place under stimulation from the side of external influences, impinging on the so-called consciousness of man. Now, these materialists do not believe that there is a mind. Of course, about soul, they say that anybody who talks about the soul is an idiot of the impossible variety. But this thing has been believed in by humanity, by the followers of all religions, that the human personality is composed of three constituents, the body and the mind and the soul. Taking it for granted as a hypothesis, if we start, we find that the mind has got numerous dimensions. Basically, it has three dimensions, that which is called the psyche, has three dimensions: cognition, cognition, volition. Knowledge, feeling and will. Then it has other dimensions also, about which modern parapsychology speaks. This is normal psychology, which says that psyche or mind has three dimensions. But abnormal psychology, or what they call now parapsychology, it is speaking of certain other dimensions of the mind. For instance, the term ESP is very well known, and ESP stands for extrasensory perception. And the experiments that have been carried on, even in under atheism, like those which have been carried on by the scientists of the Soviet Union, for instance, they have proved, and they have actually put into practice, that a person sitting in Leningrad, as the magazines and journals of USSR have reported, that a person sitting in Leningrad can talk without any physical medium to a person who is in Moscow. This is the experiment which they have performed already, you see, and which is well on the way. Now, this is non-physical communication, communication without any physical means. I am talking about this because I want to impress on you that the mind has dimensions about which we are not aware and we are not conscious, and those things are not taught to us. And it is only at a high level of scholarship in the field of psychology that a person becomes conscious of the fact that mind has numerous other dimensions. Those dimensions about which modern psychology has already spoken, and the psychologists are not speaking in those terms because of any faith that they have as Christians or as Muslims, they have been speaking in terms of pure scientific thought, and they have been able to pinpoint so many dimensions. And of course, I think that is probably only the beginning. When they go beyond that, they will be able to probe into the other regions and other dimensions of the mind as to what potentialities mind has. But as an American psychologist who is an eminent scientist, he observed, he said that mankind has not been able to make use of even 50% of potentialities that are there in the human mind. Whatever he means thereby, he knows best. But we know one thing, and I have to talk here in very simple terms. I am not standing here as professor, I am standing here as Maulana Fazlur Rahman Ansari, speaking to an audience. I would not like to take you into details. But one thing is very certain, and that is within the experience of every human being. The cognitive side of the psyche or the mind, the knowledge side, can be developed by human beings and has been developed, where miracles have taken place in the domain of thought. That is very well known. I mean, say the mind of Einstein was not the same, or development of the mind of Einstein was not the same as that of XYZ, of the ordinary human beings. Now here is a whole scale by which we can judge how this particular aspect of the mind can be evolved, developed, and we can progress in this direction, particular direction, and achieve great results. Simply in the domain of thought, that we know. Now, process of knowledge is from the known to the unknown. So, those realms of mind which are unknown or which might be fundamentally unknown, about them we will have to go from the side of what is known. Now, in connection with the feeling side of the mind, those who are students of psychiatry know the different types of phenomena which take place simply because of disturbance in the emotional side of the psyche. And disturbance in the emotional side of the psyche can even bring about physiological changes and physical consequences. A man who gets a shock, mental shock, in the feeling side of his mind may die without any physical reason. A man who gets some enjoyment from something, his physical appetite and other physical factors develop healthily just because of the effect of that emotional side of the psyche. Here the cause and the effect are different. The cause is emotional, effect is physiological or physical. Now, if this can be developed to the same heights that mankind has been developing in general the cognitive side of the mind, then you will come across phenomena which you might not have conceived. And those who are called mystics, or those who are called that they possess spiritualism or spirituality, many of them work on this side of the mind, that is the feeling side. If you read the writings of the mystics, you will find that this feeling side is well emphasized there. The greatest emphasis is on the feeling side. Then if you come to yoga, for instance, you find that the entire emphasis of yoga is on the third dimension of the mind, and that is the will. If you had the occasion of reading books on yoga, you find that they give you exercises whereby you can subject your will to a sort of tension whereby you can bring forth the potentialities that are hidden in the will. It is called development of willpower. And on the basis of this, the Hindu yogis and even Buddhist yogis, both of them, they are able to demonstrate things before the people which are considered by them to be nothing short of miracles. For a common man, miracle is an occurrence which is beyond him or which is beyond his conception. That is a miracle. Something extraordinary, because every human being measures everything with the tape of his own personality. So anything which he finds abnormal, beyond his reach, you see, he says that it is a miracle. Although all these feats which are performed on the basis of the cognitive side of the mind, or on the basis of feeling side of the mind, or on the basis of the volitional side of the mind or the will, none of these phenomena are in any sense of the word miracles, because they follow an immutable law, and anybody can perform those feats who undergoes that training. On this basis, I would say that the word ruhaniyat, which has been put down here in the question, is vague. Ruhaniyat is based on ruh, and unless there is a certain dimension of the ruh or the soul which is operative and which functions at a particular level, the word ruhaniyat cannot be used, and is being used by people in a very confused manner. You may use the word mystical, or you may use the word psychical, but you cannot use this word ruhaniyat or spirituality or spiritualism, unless the activity of a person who is practicing it is ingrained in his soul and not in his mind or body. Here then we come to the distinction that has been laid down by the Muslim Sufis between yoga and other things of that type and their own pursuit. Ignorant people try to classify both in one category. But those who know it very well that they stand poles apart. Poles apart. The Hindu yogi is a psychical scientist. Nothing beyond that. In his emotional side, he is a coward. Without meaning any insult to him, I am using the word scientifically. He is a coward because he wants, his philosophy is the philosophy of escape. The Hindu yogi and the Buddhist yogi, both of them want escape. Christian mystic wants escape. Their philosophy is that of escape or withdrawal. Withdrawal from the world, from the activities of the world, the basis is asceticism. And consequently, without meaning any insult to the Hindu mystics or Buddhist mystics, I'd say that this is the process of cowardice. The Sufi believes just the contrary. His philosophy is absolutely different. He is a believer in one God. He regards God as the really real in terms of philosophy, or the only reality, and as the source of all life and light and wisdom and beauty and truth and justice and of everything good in this world. The doctrine of the Sufi is to cultivate love for God. He is God intoxicated. He is not in the field of science there in that manner, you see that. To cultivate love for God. He is God intoxicated. He is not in the field of science there in that manner, you see that he is trying to build up the dimensions of the psyche or doing this thing or that. No, absolutely not. He is very different. His philosophy is, and this is the ruhaniyat according to Islam. His philosophy is that this entire universe and the human being, everything, whatever blessings it possesses, all those blessings come only from one source. They come only from one God or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That God is most beautiful, that God is most majestic, that God is most wise, and so on. And consequently, the Sufi argues, or the Islamic spiritualist argues, if a rose flower is so beautiful, or if so many things in nature, they are so beautiful, how beautiful must he be who has created this beauty? If certain human beings are so wise, how wise must he be who has created these wise beings? If certain human beings are so powerful, how powerful must he be who has created these powerful beings? So on he goes. This is the quest of the Sufi. He looks at creation, entire creation, as a divine piece of art. As a divine piece of art. And through creation, he goes to the love of God. And in his love, he wants to embrace God, so to say. Of course, God is infinite and man is finite. He can never embrace him. But you see, love always creates this situation that the lover wants to own and possess the beloved, That is the goal of love, to possess. And so long as the beloved is out of reach, the lover remains in a state of storm, in a state of stormy attitudes. He is worried and he is grieved, and he writes an elegy and goes out in the wilderness and cries the name of his beloved, as Majnu used to do about Layla, or others who have been classical lovers among human beings. So consequently, when a human being takes to this, not to find out what are the dimensions of the psyche and what are the dimensions of a certain material thing, he says, I want to know the very creator of all these things. These are all fleeting things. These are all mere sport. Nothing. I mean, say, if I can communicate from here to my home in Karachi, just nothing. I can communicate through the wireless, or sometime later I'll be able to communicate through the Telestar system, communicate anywhere with the world, or I might communicate, if not through the electronic particles, then through some other particles which are mystical and mystifying. The Sufi says all this is a vain quest. Search out him who has created this world, who is the source and the embodiment of all good and of all excellence and of all perfect. So you will be able to distinguish between a Sufi and the mystics, and never make this mistake of using this vague term Ruhaniyat. The Sufi also does not believe in Ruhaniyat. The only thing he believes in is God. God is everything for him. Number two, in God's creation, the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam is everything for him, because he forms the medium between him and God. There is no other way. He finds no other way except that. He has to follow the entire kalima, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. So when he goes in search for God, he finds that he cannot reach there until and unless he takes full help from the spiritual dynamo and the dynamic spiritual personality of the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Now in this quest, we can use the term Ruhaniyat only on one ground. And that ground is that, as I told you in the beginning, the body is spatio-temporal. The mind is temporal. The soul is spaceless and timeless. And because the soul is spaceless and timeless, and God also is spaceless and timeless, therefore there is an affinity between the human personality. The point of contact can only be the soul. Because God is absolute, and absolute means spaceless and timeless, that is, God transcends space and time. God transcends the limitations of space and time. And the soul is spaceless and timeless. Therefore, the affinity that exists is between the soul and God. And consequently, this entire journey is undertaken by the Sufi on the wings of the soul. And the energy which is consumed in this journey is the energy of love. The fuel which he uses for this pilgrimage to fly to greater and greater heights in quest of God, that fuel is love or ishq. I am going on talking only on this first question, but I don't know, it's a very complicated question. I don't know how far I have been able to clarify this term Ruhaniyat, because the question is, what is Ruhaniyat? Ruhaniyat in Islam is to become the slave of God. And there is no way open for any sensible human being but to adopt this slavery. And what happens? May I tell you what happens? And what is the real process? I'll illustrate it to you by way of an example. I'll give you two examples. The first example is how this ruhaniyat is acquired, or this godliness, or whatever you may say, is acquired in Islam. You see, ruhaniyat is acquired, or as compared to God, is just nothing. So the Sufi has got to negate himself. I am nothing. And of course, we are nothing as compared to God, because God alone has got the absolute existence. Absolute existence, He alone has got the absolute reality. If we are, then we are only relatively real. Relatively real, not absolutely real. Not real in the real sense of the word. You see, we are real just in the sense as you see in a cinema house. It depends on the fiat of the will of the cinema operator. He puts on the switch and you find a whole world there, with all the emotions and all comedies, tragedies, and everything going on. You see, he puts off the switch, there is nothing. That is our reality. That is our reality. Now, in Sufi terminology, I may say, the Sufi says that in my own self, I am dead. In my own self, I am a dead thing. My life consists in living in God, through God. If you cannot understand the word in God, of course the Quran has used this word, in God, but probably you will not be able to understand it properly, through God. Now, take up an experiment from physics. The sun, imagine the sun on the sky. What are the two fundamental qualities of the sun which you observe? Heat and light. Heat and light, all right. Take a convex lens. Convex lens. The convex lens possesses neither heat nor light. All right. Focus the convex lens before the sun. The moment you focus this dead convex lens before the sun, a sun emerges on the surface. An image of the sun emerges on the surface of that convex lens. Its light is so dazzling that you cannot concentrate your gaze on this sun, which has come into being. And if you keep it focused there, then it will also give heat. Keep your palm of the hand below it and it will start burning it. That sun, which is that image of the sun, which is created on the surface of the convex lens. Huh? So this convex lens becomes the slave of the sun, places itself in an attitude of abject passivity, and stays in focus. This is what we have been asked to do in Islam. Focus this convex lens of the heart before God and keep it focused. And not this mere ritualism that people feel that if they have grown a beard of a certain measure, and if they have got pajamas of a certain measure, if they have got kurtas of a certain measure, they are doing something tremendous in the way of piety. Not that. This is the lesson of Islam. You have got to fix up this convex lens of yours, which is dead, which has neither light nor heat. In abject slavery, focus it before God, and it will start absorbing divine blessings. It will start absorbing divine attributes and qualities. And that's why the Holy Quran says about the human beings, that they are the vicegerents of God. Vicegerents of God in what sense? In the sense in which the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam has given us the guidance. He says, تَخَلَّقُوا بِأَخْلَاقِ اللَّهِ. Imbue yourselves with divine attributes. Create in yourselves the divine qualities. That is the goal of a Muslim. Not this ordinary goal of this psychological gymnastics of yoga or this thing or that thing, not this. To be a reflector of the divine attributes, of the qualities of the divine personality. And what happens? When a Muslim becomes the slave of God, which is the highest stage that creation can reach, the highest in God's creation is Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And about that you have got to affirm every now and then, وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. That I affirm that Muhammad is the slave of Allah. Now this slavery of God, as I told you, when this convex lens takes to this slavery of the sun, in a very partial manner, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that one, when anyone from among my servants labors to win my love through the process which I have laid down for him, then there does arrive a stage when I make him my beloved. Ahbabtuhu, I make him my beloved. And when I have made him my beloved, then I become his eyes with which he sees. I become his ears with which he hears. I become his tongue with which he speaks. I become his hands with which he holds. I become his feet with which he walks. These are the actual words of the hadith in Bukhari. It is not that God incarnates in him. It is the reflection of divine attributes in him which takes this form. But remember one thing. Remember one thing, and here comes that question of saints, which has been asked as corollary to this question. Remember one thing. A person about whom God says that I become his eyes with which he sees, will anything in this vast universe be hidden from the eyes of that person? A person about whom God says that I become his ears with which he hears, will there be any sound in this entire universe which his ears cannot hear? And in the same manner about all other things, we can say that if we are human beings, this slave of God becomes superhuman. Being human, he still becomes something like superhuman, you see, because he is much beyond us. That is one aspect of this ruhaniyat in Islam. I wanted to give another point also, which is very important. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the law that nobody can come into his presence, although he is everywhere and he is the Lord of all. He says that my beloved in creation, in entire creation, my beloved par excellence is the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Those who come through him will get the audience. Those who don't come through him cannot get the audience. Perhaps the words I am speaking are very simple, but I would like to illustrate this point from physical science. You see, everywhere there is a powerhouse for electricity. I mean, see, in those townships where you have the electric current, there is the powerhouse built. Now, the law is that electricity which is produced in the powerhouse is produced at a high voltage. The voltage may be 1,000, the voltage may be 10,000, or it may be 1,000,000, or whatever it may be. But it can be supplied to the homes and the factories and other places at a very low voltage. In Pakistan, it is 220. I don't know what it is here. It may be just something near about. Now, what happens? On the one hand, electricity has got to be produced at a high voltage, but it cannot be supplied at that high voltage. If the supply of electricity were to take place through the wires which connect the different buildings from the powerhouse, if that high voltage were to be released, all these poles and all these wires and all the houses and all buildings will burn to ashes. That is a well-known fact of science. What do they do? When they find all these facts, what do the scientists do? They do this, that they produce electricity as they are compelled to do at a high voltage. Then they establish transformers. These transformers bring down the voltage at each level. The first transformer cuts it into half. The second transformer cuts the voltage into 1/4, and like that until it comes to 220 or 30, whatever it is, and then it can be used. Then alone it is allowed to go into the homes, otherwise not. Understood? I think it is very simple. Now, the entire life of everything in this universe, in all dimensions, for that there is only one powerhouse, and that is the personality of God. The personality of God is the powerhouse from which life and light and beauty and knowledge and everything flows. So his blessings must flow into this universe and everything of this universe, in order that this universe and the things of this universe can function and can remain alive. But the Quran says that the radiations of this powerhouse are so infinitely powerful that once the very great prophet Moses, Musa alayhi salam, who is one of the very eminent prophets of God, and who is Kalimullah, who could directly converse with God, this great, great man, he pleaded with God, "I just want to have a little view, a glimpse of your majesty, O God, your majesty personality." The words of the Quran are, "Rabbi Arini, O Lord, show thyself to me." What did God answer? He said, "Lantarani. Lantarani, you can never see me, O Moses. You are not capable of it. Walakin inzur ila al-jabali fa in istaqarra makanahu fa sawfa tarani." Just because you are my messenger, I don't want to hurt your feelings, but the actual fact is that you are incapable of it. Just look at the mountain, which is so solid and rocky, black rocks. These stiff black rocks, I will cast just a little image of my glory. Witness this. If this mountain can bear the impact of my radiations, even in the slightest degree, you might also desire, because you are, after all, superior to a mountain as a personality. وَلَكِنْ انظُرْ إِلَى الْجَبَلِ فَإِنِ اسْتَقَرَّ مَكَانَهُ فَسَوْفَ تَرَانِي فَلَمَّا تَجَلَّى رَبُّهُ لِلْجَبَلْ جَعَلَهُ دَكَّمْ وَخَرَّ مُوسَى صَيْقًا. When that small glimpse of the radiations of the personality of God fell on Mount Sinai, that portion where it fell was turned into ashes. And its vibrations that were created, although Moses was standing at some distance and they had not fallen on him, those vibrations make him faint and he fell. I mean, say this we know about the atomic blast, that wherever atomic blast takes place, then in that particular area it turns everything into ashes. But even outside of that particular area, its radiations have a very devastating effect on the human beings. So the Quran says that Moses fainted. And when Moses got up, فَلَمَّا أَفَاقَ, when he regained his consciousness, قَالَ, he said, سُبْحَانَكَ, glorious thou, O Lord. Inni tubtu ilayk, I repent from what I said. I'll never ask thee again for this. This is Quranic testimony. I'm not talking in terms of fiction. This world, nothing is in this world is capable of bearing the impact. And therefore God Almighty, out of his mercy, created the first transformer. And that first transformer in this entire creation is the personality of the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. When the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam says, as we read in Sahih al-Bukhari, when he says to one of his companions, Sayyidina Jabir, O Jabir, the first thing that God created in this entire creation was the light of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. This is the cosmic aspect, the transcendental dimension of the personality of the Prophet about which I am speaking. This cosmic Muhammad, or the Noor-e Muhammadi as it is called in Muslim thought, this which was the starting point and which is the foundation of this entire universe, is a part and parcel of the personality of historical Muhammad. Remember this. People saw him as a human being, definitely so. But this historical personality is a part and parcel of the same cosmic personality which was there at the dawn of creation. And it is this personality which is the first transformer. This personality alone has the capacity in entire creation to absorb the radiations of the personality of God directly. The Quran bears witness. While it speaks of Musa alayhi salam, in those terms, it speaks about the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam in connection with his Mi'raj. It says, the Quran says, that the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, he traveled towards reality, towards God, towards that point where the radiations of the personality of God are concentrated. And he reached nearness to the extent which is to be found between the two ends of a bow. فَكَانَ قَابَ قَوْسَيْنِ أَوْ أَدْنَى. And then it bears witness that being so near to those radiations, and here I might just tell you, if you are in a room, a small room, 10 feet by 10 feet by 10 feet, and 10 bulbs of 1000 volts are lighted there in that room, you will go mad. Your nerves cannot bear the impact of that dazzling light. Remember this, and then think of this, what the Quran is saying about the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. It says that he stood in the presence of those dazzling radiations, the concentration of radiations of the personality of God. مَا زَاغَ الْبَصَرُ وَمَا طَغَى. His eyes winked not, nor was there the slightest disturbance in his nerves and his emotions. With serenity and perfect dignity, he faced them. This is Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And the Sufis believe in this. Those unfortunate people who are absolutely blind to the realities of the transcendental dimension, they are unable to understand all this. The Islamic cosmogony is that the first transformer is the heart of the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, and then there are other transformers in the serial line, the hearts of all those Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam who came, and then the hearts of those who became Awliya Allah. And it is through these transformers that the blessings of God flow into this dead universe and give life. That's why I was saying that the Sufi philosophy is this. Their goal is God, but their vehicle is love for the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, and all-absorbing love. They start in this fashion and they have reached the goal. And when they reach the goal, as I have said, as it is said in Bukhari, that God says that I become their eyes with which they see, and I become their ears with which they hear. I may take up here that other point also. Allahu Akbar. This is 15 minutes past 10. I may take up here the other point also. And that point is about the status of a Wali Allah after his death. What happens after death, according to Islam, is that a sinful person becomes embroiled in the tortures of his own evil deeds. A person who has balanced his life, goodness, piety on the one hand and some sins on the other, he is asked to be in a state of passivity. As we read the verse in the Holy Quran, Noom ka nomil urus, take rest like a bride. He is asked to be in a state of passivity. As we read the verse in the Holy Quran, Noom ka nomil urus, take rest like a bride after her nuptial night. Be at rest. But those who come under the category of الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ, those who are the favorites of those who have attained that status of being blessed by God, who are the repositories of God's blessings, الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ, and there are four categories, النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالصَّالِحِينَ. This is what the Quran says. God's prophets, the martyrs, those who rose to be Siddiq, are the embodiments of truth. And then the martyrs, and then the Salihin, or the righteous, who have attained the status of being Wali Allah. Now about them, what happens is that while a normal Muslim, I might use the word normal Muslim, has to enjoy a sort of repose in the timeless existence of Alam al-Barzakh, that is timeless, where time is zero, in this sense time. These people who, through their cultivation of love for God and their realization of the truth, who have entered into the categories of being blessed by God, about them, the Quran says, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْسَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Whoever from among the males or the females, from among the men or the women, is a believer and leads the life of righteousness truly and comprehensively and genuinely, then he or she gets two rewards. One reward is that he or she is revived into functioning life immediately after death. You might have heard the words that so and so was granted freedom of the city of Edinburgh, and so was granted freedom of the city of London, and so on. These people are granted the freedom of this next world. And because man is superior to the angels, the Khalifatullah is superior to the angels, not the sinful human beings. Those who become God's beloveds, those who become friends of God, or those who become awliya Allah, they are awarded this. They are given this reward. فَلَنُحْيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I revive them immediately after death into a new functioning life, which is extremely healthy and pure and extremely, I mean, say it is a life of felicity. وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. And I will reward them in the most beautiful manner after the day of judgment. The reward which is to come after the day of judgment, that has been mentioned separately from this thing, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I revive them. And what happens? Because man is superior to angels, and the angels are the functionaries of God in this universe, about which the whole Islamic theology stands as proof. These people are joined to the company of the angels and they are made their leaders. These awliya Allah become the leaders of companies of angels because they are superior to the angels. And they become functionaries and they have the freedom. And just as the angels, about the angels, the Holy Quran says that they are all the time seeking forgiveness of God for everyone who is living on the earth. The words of the Quran are يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ لِمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ, about the malaika, that is the function of the malaika. يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ لِمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ, that is an attitude of goodwill and love, which means that the malaika love the human beings, so that they pray for the forgiveness of God for all God's creation on the earth. Or at another place the Quran says about the angels, هُوَ الَّذِي يُصَلِّي عَلَيْكُمْ وَمَلَائِكَتُهُ لِيُخْرِجَكُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. The malaika of God are all the time assisting spiritually the Muslims to attain to greater and greater heights in godliness. So what should be the function of these saints after death? Should their attitude be as leaders of groups of angels, sympathy and love for human beings whom they have left behind? Or should it be one of indifference? Logically, it should be the attitude of goodwill and love for all those who are on the earth. Because now they are in the angelic group. And about the angels, the Holy Quran has said this. And consequently, those who go and pay their homage to the saints naturally can go only to their graves. That is the only approach for them. Of course, the saints are not there in the graves. It is their body which has been laid down there. But these graves are the station from where you can contact their souls or their spaceless and timeless persons. Anybody who goes there and pays homage to them, they cannot be so discourteous as not to be in a mood to help them by God's grace. They have been appointed to help. This is their prerogative. This is the special reward which they have earned from God. They are not like other Muslims or other human beings who are of the ordinary type. And consequently, human beings can derive benefits by going there, by offering the Fatiha, which is the manner of paying homage, not by doing anything which is of the nature of shirk or anything of that sort, remaining within the confines of the Sharia. But this thing, if they do, in the manner in which Islam wants them to do, they will undoubtedly be benefited by going there spiritually or in other things as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may like. My dear brothers, I was asked on the telephone by Mr. Abu Kala. He told me that after arriving here, I'll be asked to be only for half an hour with the ladies. And I don't know what dimension is this in which I am seeing only the figures of me. And my physical energy, if I consume it unwisely, probably I'll be committing a sin. So I would like to take leave of you. If the questions are of a nature that they require explanations, of course, I have tried to simplify everything, and I have tried to be very moderate. I have not gone into details at all, just to give you a fundamental idea. But I hope that you will understand this, because this is the real Islam and not mere rituals, of which this is the spirit and the rituals are only the body. The body without the soul is a dead body, and rituals without this spirit of love for God are something soulless. I hope that my advice and whatever I have been able to say tonight will kindle in the hearts of those who have listened to me to rise higher than what they have been and to try to acquire that status about which I have spoken, that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all, enable us all to become His wali or awliya Allah, acquire this status. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sir Ansari's beautiful and well-delivered lecture inspires us with even a 10 voltage of electricity.
Sacrifice for others. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that it is the fundamental, unavoidable characteristic of Muslim life. يُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةٌ وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. That it is impossible to find a person who is genuinely a Muslim, that he will not be such. What? يُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. The genuine Muslims always sacrifice everything that they can afford for the benefit and service of others, even though it may cause them hardship. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ. He who is saved from the greed of his ego, from the greed which is born of selfishness, he alone is successful with God and in this life. So the principle of unity, of Muslim unity, is governed by these two principles. Unless the community follows these two principles, it will be merely a lip affirmation. And examples of this unity are numerous. I may not relate them. I may just relate one example. Unity born of love, how it was demonstrated in Muslim life. We read in the books of Hadith that during a battle between the Muslims and the Kafirs, during the time of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, there were several Muslims who were wounded, who were severely wounded. And there were Muslims who were volunteers who had to take water or do this job of nursing for the wounded soldiers. A voice arises from one quarter, Al-Atash, Al-Atash, I am thirsty, I am thirsty, and this man was about to die of his wounds. The person who was in charge of this duty of carrying water to the wounded soldiers, he ran towards him with water. And when he reached him, by the time he reached him, another voice arose from another quarter, I am thirsty, I am thirsty, I am dying. This dying man who had called him first said, I will not drink water until this other brother of mine drinks it. Go to him. He was dying of thirst. He had called him. He said, go to him and first of all, the water to him. So this man ran towards that other person, and when he reached that other person, that second person, a voice came from a third person, "I am thirsty, I am thirsty, I am dying." The second man also said the same thing which the first man had said, "I won't drink water until he drinks water." And when he reached that third person, he was already dead. And when he came back to the second person, he was also dead. And when he came back to the first person, he was also dead. I'm sorry. This is the extent of selfless service to our fellow Muslims and to human beings in general, which was inculcated in Islam by the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. This overflowing love, this unbounded love between Muslims that builds them up into a unified force. And what was the consequence? The consequence was that the greatest miracle in the history of mankind took place. Muslims were able to meet the greatest challenges from the Roman Empire and the Iranian Empire and from within and from without. In the most glorious manner. And they became the master people of the world. They became the only superpower in the world. And not only a superpower, they became the teachers of the highest morals and the highest spirituality and the highest advancements in the field of scientific knowledge and industrial knowledge and technological knowledge and in all those things. This was born of unity. As things went on, this unity came, as I was speaking here yesterday. Wealth corrupts and power corrupts. Muslims had wealth and power both. So after a time, their original spirit began to flag, and they became entangled in the materialistic pursuits of life, in the materialist outlook on life. And what happened? All our defeats in history, all our setbacks in history which took place in later times and which are taking place with greater tempo nowadays, have been due to one great factor, disunity. For instance, I may remind you of the decisive war that took place between the combined forces of Europe and Muslims in the heart of France. The Muslim armies were led by Abdul Rahman, the Umayyad Khalifa of Spain. The Christian armies were constituted of the French, the Germans, Slovaks, and so many other nations. The battle took place at Poitiers near Paris. The Muslims routed the combined might of Europe. But after they had routed the combined might of Europe, and now the entire Europe lay at their feet to be a Muslim continent in future, disunity arose between the Berbers and the Arabs. Muslim army was constituted of two elements, Arab soldiers and Berber soldiers. Disunity arose among them as regards the booty. And they started fighting among themselves during the night after they had won the victory during the day. And when the Christian force, when the forces of Europe had been retreating, message reached them that the Muslim soldiers are fighting among themselves. So they turned back, hit them hard, crushed them to pieces, and threw them back into Spain. And after that, Muslims never had any opportunity to go back to France to conquer Europe. Not only this, those forces who routed them because of their disunity, they ultimately expelled them even from Spain, even in the most ignominious manner. And later on, they ruled over them in Morocco and Mauritania and Algeria and Tunis and Libya and all over, from where Muslims had gone to Spain. This was one fruit of disunity. Or this powerful empire which Muslims had built in India, in the Indo-Pakistan subcontinent, where Muslim ruled for 800 years. Why did this empire fail? Why did this empire fall? Because of Muslim disunity. Because the provinces of the empire under Muslim governors said, we want to be sovereign and independent of the central government at Delhi. So Muslim India became divided into different states. And then small groups of East India Company, British East India Company and French East India Company and this East India Company and that East India Company, small groups of merchants could snatch away the Muslim empire from them and establish their own. It was because of disunity. It is because of disunity that in spite of the fact that the Muslims of South Africa, so far as their Islamic enthusiasm and love for Islam is concerned, form one of the finest Muslim communities in the world. In spite of this fact, they have not been able to make any achievement. They have not been able to solve their problems, and the problems have continued to multiply until they have taken a very ugly shape, and we are thinking as to what is going to happen to our youth tomorrow. When these youths become adults, what is going to happen to Islam and to Muslims in this country? The problems have multiplied because we have been disunited. Because we have been disunited into different types of groups. And the only solution lies for this small community which is here and which can play a very glorious role for itself and for the country at large. The only solution lies in drowning all differences for the sake of God, not for the sake of anyone else. For the sake of love of the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, who is our only leader and to whom we owe a pledge of loyalty. And we are the flag bearers of his mission, every Muslim. This is the only way. And in this connection, I admire the spirit and the outlook of the Muslim youth movement for taking the first practical steps. I congratulate Dr. Kotwal on his very scientific analysis of the norms and concepts which govern the Islamic way of life. And I would plead to all of you, carry this message to every Muslim home and hamlet. Stand, united we stand, and divided we fall, and our fall will be such that the very name of Islam will ultimately be wiped off from this country. And my parting message in this lecture of mine is, make this motto of your life, the motto with which Islam started and with which Islam flourished. Love for God and love for fellow being. And Allah will bless you in a manner which you cannot imagine. May Allah bless you all. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.